We're going to ask Sister Irene Tidwell to come at this time. She's going to take us further and introduce the speaker for this morning.
Amen.
So, Sister Irene.
Is a delight. She is a woman with many hats. She is most definitely a counselor, and I've used her. She is young enough to be a sister. She has enough wisdom and knowledge to be a mother figure. She is a joy. She has such a loving spirit that when she corrects you, you can't help but laugh. How many people you know that make you feel good when they correct you? But she does. And she is really intelligent. And again, wisdom follows her all the time. Now, I know some of you know who I'm talking about. And like I said, she has many hats. So welcome, sister, pastor, mother, Marilyn Hill. Well, I was going to stand down there, but my eyes are getting a little old and dim. I shouldn't confess that, should I? But it's a little bit more light up here, and we're just going to stand here this morning. Well, I have a timekeeper. Pastor is not here. He's out of town today. And he told me, he says, now, don't make me look bad today, because if you do, they may not ever want to hear me anymore. So I says, there's no danger in that. But anyway, I am just glad to stand before you today. I have a timekeeper, and I told him that I would be finished in 25 minutes, but I'm going to ask the timekeeper if he would just give me a grace period and give me 10 more minutes before he holds his hand up. He knows who it is. So I usually hold the cards on Pastor, but he's not here today to hold it on me. So I could run away with it, good. But I'm not going to do that. Well, I just wanted to say it's a pleasure to be here this morning to stand before you. It's been a long time since I've been here. And I certainly hope today, when you depart from this place, that you will either have at least one or two things that you can take with you that will help you along the way. Amen, amen, amen. Our Father God, just let us pray briefly. Father God, we come into your presence this morning with humble hearts, seeking your face. We thank you for your grace. We thank you for your mercy and for all the blessings that abound toward us. We give you praise. We give you the glory. We ask that you just bless these, your people today, Lord. These, our people. Oh, God, give them ears to hear, hearts to understand. Oh, God, so that they become more doers of the word. And not just hearers only, deceiving them of themselves. Father God, we ask these blessings in the name of Jesus. We thank you. Amen and amen. Well, get ready. When confronted with desperate situations, what do you do? What do you do? Well, I'm going to tell you, you've heard Pastor talk a lot about there is a Godward side of us, and there is a manward side. And let me tell you, The Godward side, God has already done what he's going to do in terms of the redemption, and he's given us precious promises, and also he's given us his word. His word. It's signed, sealed, and delivered. Signed, sealed, and delivered. This is our blueprint. Amen. So we know that when we have a blueprint, if we follow it, just like we're building a house, it's 11 o'clock. Okay, when we have a blueprint, we follow that blueprint, we can kind of see the end from the beginning. Amen. If we follow the blueprint. If we follow the blueprint, we can kind of see the end from the beginning. So this morning, I just want to give you just a little blueprint, my own blueprint for the Godward side, and there is a manward side. Here is the Godward side. Now then, I'm going to talk about both today. I'm going to integrate the Godward side and the manward side. Now then, many times we hear the scripture, and where is Brother Wayne? Where is he in the house? I saw him earlier. Brother Wayne, on Wednesday night, I spoke so beautifully, and I was sitting there, and I'm thinking, he's taking my message. That's my scripture. This is what I was going to talk about Sunday. Oh, that, but you know what? It was just confirmation. Thank you, Brother Wayne. It was so, so good. Amen. So I'm going to focus, as I said, more heavily on the manward side. Nonetheless, I will speak about the Godward side as well. Now, I'm going to give you 4 points today. 4 points. And point number one is when we are confronted with desperate times, what do we do? Point number one is we call upon God for help in desperate times. I heard Sister Candy just read the word, and Sister Candy, 119th Psalms is one of my favorite also. When you hide that word in your heart, hide the word in your heart, then when those desperate situations come, you know what to do. Hide the word in your heart. Desperate situations, tragedies, none of us escape from them. We all experience these hardships. You know, I was trying to think of a provocative beginning the other night when I came across a newspaper article. And this is the article. I like to read, and I like to read hear the news, watch the news. Although most of it is bad news, but I still want to know what's going on. The headlines read, OSU instructor is killed in a four-vehicle collision. OSU instructor is killed in a four-vehicle collision. Now, let me tell you about that. This young lady's name was Monica Dudley. She was, anybody heard about her? Okay, 27 years old. Here's a picture of her if you haven't seen it. She was a beautiful young lady. Graduated from OSU 2006 with a bachelor's degree. Received a master's degree in 2008. Began teaching on the faculty in 2006. Outstanding young lady. In the process of pursuing a doctoral degree in educational leadership and policy, and was teaching in the College of Arts and Sciences and coordinated 2 academic programs. What accolades! What an impressive resume! Nonetheless, her life was snuffed out instantly in that head-on collision. The account is that she was pinned in the car for 4 hours. 4 hours. And when they were finally able to free her, she was pronounced dead at the scene. Why did this happen? Why did that occur? I don't know. and you don't know either. But one thing that I do know, that the her family, her friends, her co-workers, all who are hardworking now, what do they need to do? This is a desperate situation for them. They need to look at the verse of scripture as found in Psalms 50:15. What do you do? You call upon the Lord. Call upon me in the day of trouble. And what did he promise? He said, I will deliver you. He didn't say I maybe. He said, I will deliver you. Now I have the firsthand experience of knowing what those parents and friends are feeling. Because it was in November 1995 when I was preparing for my Thanksgiving dinner that I getting ready to make homemade rojo, and I received this phone call, and somehow I knew I must answer it. Somehow, you know how sometimes you ignore certain calls, but this one I knew I must answer. And it was a call from a relative back home that says, Marilyn, your father just got killed in a car accident. Oh, that was a devastating blow for me. Because I loved my father. My father was my mentor. He was my friend. But do you know what I did? That was a desperate situation for me. I began to call upon the Lord. Yes. Call upon the Lord, and do you know he answered me? And then in 1 Peter 5:7, I knew that I could cast my cares upon him, for he cares for me. Now, when you cast your cares upon him, you throw it upon him. It's like you just don't go and just say, oh, Lord, here it is, here it is. If you're a fisherman, Brother Beauty, you are, when you cast, I don't know that much about fishing, but when you throw that thing out there, you do it with a vengeance, don't you? You put that thing out there. That's the way you do with those cares. You cast them upon him, for he cares for you. And you don't take them back. And let me tell you something else. The scripture says in 1 Corinthians 10:13, you know that you can call upon him in desperate times and he will hear you. Yes. He will hear you. It's no ifs, ands, or maybes about it. He will hear you. Now, 1 Corinthians, there are solace in it. There is solace in the word of God. There are solace when you get in and eke out the scriptures and you study the word. Even when it seems like nothing is happening, there are solace. 1 Corinthians 10:13 tells us that there is no temptation taken you, but such that is common to man. But what did it say? But God, glory to God, but God is faithful, and he will not allow you to be tempted above that which you're able. But he will, with that temptation, provide a way of escape so that you may be able to bear it. Now listen, listen. I know some of you are going through some things today, and it may be heavy on your heart. But do know that there is somebody that's going through the same thing. Same thing, maybe different principles, different players rather, but the principle is the same. Now, if you think in all of God's green earth, whatever it is that you're going through, you're not in it alone. Somebody else is going through that same thing. You did not pioneer the way on whatever you're going through. You didn't pioneer the way. Just put that in your pipe. No, you don't smoke. Just remember that. You didn't pioneer the way. Amen, amen. And you have to know that whatever it is that you're going through, I want you to hear me. Hear me today. This too shall pass. Amen. This too shall pass. It didn't come to stay. It came to pass. Yes. All right. Now, there are many situations that we endure, we have to encounter. Oh, my time is getting away. There's broken dreams that we have, maybe dysfunctional marriages, long-term unemployment, loneliness. Maybe you're in a house that's about to foreclose. You may say, I don't have those problems, but my utility is about to be turned off. If that's your problem, it's real for you. Okay, maybe you have no money. But even in spite of those situations, what do? Point number two, you assess your situation. You always, first and foremost, and then you weigh your options. Assess your situation, whatever it is you're in, and you weigh your options. Now, as I said earlier, I like to look at the news. And on yesterday, yes, it was yesterday, I saw on the news a young football player by the name of Mark, and I believe I have this last name correct. Well, I'm not sure. Whatever. All right. Some of y'all may know him. He was once named the Defensive Player of the Year in college. He was a first round draft pick preparing for the pros, and I think he was playing in the pros when he found himself in a desperate situation. He became ill. And after going to the doctor, he discovered that he had cancer of the bone. Football player, promising career, pro ahead of him. The doctor said, sorry, Mark, but it looks like we're going to have to remove your thigh bone. Mark knew that if that happened, he would never play football again. So what did he do? That was a desperate situation. Remember, when you are in desperate situations, what do you do? Do you panic? Do you turn around? Do you say, God is not with me? Or do you go forward? What did Mark do? Mark got a second opinion. He says, I can't give up my thigh bone. I can't do this. That'll shatter my career. So he went to, he got a second opinion. The second opinion was the same. You have cancer of the bone. But they did an experiment with him. And they also gave him radiation. And with that new experiment, and with that radiation, Mark is cancer-free today. What did he do? He weighed his options. And he assessed the situation. When you're in a desperate situation, weigh your options and assess the situation. Now, on the news report, they interviewed Mark, and he stated that 92% of recovery is a state of mind. Now, that's what Mark said. Well, they said today, Mark will be playing on one of those teams in the Super Bowl. I don't know if he'll be on the field or not, but isn't that beautiful? He assessed the situation. He just didn't accept what they said, and he made a decision. When you're in those desperate situations, just don't, when many times we quote the word, we say the word, we know the word, we can do it wrong, someone can wake us up at night, we'll know it, but when it comes time to act, we don't take the action. Mark took some action. And I don't know what his religious faith is, or even if he has an affiliation or his conviction. But I just believe that he had some measure of faith to do what he did. There had to be some measure there. And Romans 1 and 17 tells us that the just shall live by faith. And we are his children. So we are just. We know that we must live by faith. We also know that faith without works is dead. So that means that we've got to be active participants with him, for we are workers together with him. Not, we don't just send God on assignment and says, Lord, you go over here, you do this, and you sit back on your laurels and do nothing. No, we are workers together with him. Remember, there's the Godward side and the manward side. And signed, sealed, delivered, all of these promises, they will remain there if we don't take some actions. And Mark took action. Now then, okay, we're going to go further in the Bible here. Point number three is determined to seek the Lord. We're going to 2 Chronicles 20. I will not read that entire passage of scripture, for I do not have time, but I will just abbreviate it. Very, very familiar passage concerning Jehoshaphat. And you know, we studied this in Bible study a while back, and Pastor has gone over and over and over, and he's been repetitive on this, so you know it quite well. But let me tell you, they were in a desperate situation. I want you to think about this morning. Some of you I know sitting here are in some desperate situations. They were in a desperate situation. What was it, the situation? A fierce host was coming against them. The Moab, Ammon, and the Mount Seir. Huge, multitude, forceful army coming against Judah. Their first response was fear. But you know what they did? They set themselves to seek the Lord. That's the first order of business. The first thing we must do when we're encountered or we're in a desperate situation, set yourself to seek the Lord. I think you should write that down. That's good. Set yourself to seek the Lord. Then what else did they do? They acknowledged God's greatness. Oh God, after he brought them all, I'm abbreviating this account because you know the story. After he called all the assembly together, men, women, children, they pronounced a fast, and I suspect some of the cattle and whatever, you know, they all were given reverence to God because this was a desperate situation. Desperate. And when Jehoshaphat stood in the assembly, my God, to pray, he acknowledged, he says, God, all power is in your hands. All of it. Even you're the ruler of all the kingdoms. Even this heathen, these heathens that's coming against us, you're the ruler of all of it. And he says, God, you're so great that none is able to stand before you. Nobody's able to stand before you. And I want to kind of skip down to verse 9, and I want to read that. It says, and you said, you see, many times we have to put God's word before him. What did he say? What did he say he would do? He's in verse 9, it says, you said, if when evil cometh upon us, that army advancing was evil, as the sword, judgment, if we stand in this house, glory to God, and in thy presence, and cry unto thee in our afflictions, then will I hear and help. Lord, you said it. So you put yourself in that situation. You stand before the Lord, whatever it is that you have to deal with, and put the word before him. Then moving on down to verse 12, it says, have no might. They were saying, Jehoshaphat said, Lord, we're helpless. Here we are. We have no might against this great company. Neither do we know what to do. Now, there are many times you're in situations when you just don't know what to do. You've been there? Anybody been there when you were in there and you said, Lord, I know what your word said. I know where I am, but I just don't know what to do. And that's what he acknowledged. We just don't know what to do. But then they say, we have no might against this great company. Neither do we know what to do. But, Lord, our eyes are upon you. Our eyes are upon you. In other words, we are looking for some deliverance from you, Lord, because I just don't know what to do. And you'll notice in those subsequent scriptures there that they had a victory. That if you read on down, and you can do this later on, you'll see that the Lord said that the battle is not yours, but it's the Lord. The battle is not yours. In those situations when you don't know what to do, just know that the battle is not yours, but it's the Lord. And subsequently, they had
victory. Now then, point four, and you please read the rest of the account to see the full scope of it, is count the cost. Think, plan, reason, and execute. God gave you his blueprint. He gave you his blueprint, and he gave all of us a brain, didn't he? For us to think, plan, reason, and execute. He wanted us to use the brain he gave us. Where's our brain? Somewhere here. And to read the word so that we can understand it. And as I said earlier, become doers of it and not just hearers only. Now, go with me to 2 Kings, the 7th chapter. I'm not going to read it because we don't have time. But I want to talk about the account of the four leprous men. Four leprous men. I don't know if you've ever seen anybody with leprosy or not, but it's not a pretty sight. Not a pretty sight at all. And anyone you've seen that they've lost their limbs and sometimes, and it's just devastating to look upon them. These four lepers were outside the gate of the city. They were out because if you had leprosy, you had to be thrown outside of the city because it was contagious. And wherever you went, you had to announce unclean, unclean, yes. Meaning that, in so many words, don't come near me because I am contagious. Well, here sat these four lepers by the gate, and there was a famine in the land. I can imagine that people that gave them food, this is not in the Bible, but I'm just imagining they probably threw it to them. Or maybe they laid it aside over here and said, you can come get it. Because keep in mind, this disease was contagious. So they knew about the famine. So they knew that they were dying because they weren't getting any food. So they discussed it among themselves. And what shall we do? This is a desperate situation. What do we do? They finally said, why sit we here and die? Why sit we here and die? So many times we're in a situation, we just become immobilized. I don't know what to do. I just don't know what to do. But what they said was, why sit we here and die? If we go into the city, they were looking at their options. Counting up the cost now. If we go into the city, there's a famine there, so we'll die. But if we just sit here, we're going to die. Then they looked at each other and said, let us fall into the hands of the Syrians. And see, the Syrians were fierce. I don't know if they were like the Syrians, what's happening. You all know what's happening in Syria now, how they're slaughtering all those people. 200 and some, just women, children lying in the street. But the Syrians in biblical times were very, very aggressive people, assertive. So they said, let us go and fall into the hands of the Syrians. If they save us alive, we shall live. But if they kill us, we'll die. They looked at their options. One really very good was it. They sat there, they would die. They go into the city, they would die. If they went into the enemy's camp, there was a good chance they would die. So they didn't have good options. But they took a step of faith. Take a step of faith. And they went into the enemy's camp. And when they got there, you know what they found? No man was there. Huh? No man was there. Now, there had been a real army, a multitude of them there. But let me tell you something. Somebody I heard some years ago that God will send, when you pray, God will send an angel on the run. And when you get there, the work is already done. Glory to God. Glory to God. He will send an angel on the run. And when you get there, the work is already done. They don't know what happened. They didn't know what happened, but the word tells us what happened. In the night, God caused, hallelujah, glory to God. The Lord made the Syrians hear a noise, and horses and chariot, and the noise of a great host. Was there a noise? Were there chariots? No, but that's what the Lord caused them to hear. And they fled. And when they fled, they left all, everything behind them. They left food. They left clothing. They left silver. And they left gold. And the leopards, can't you just see them going in there confiscating all that stuff? They gathered the spoils. Got some, went, took it back, went into another tent. It was just so much there that they just couldn't get it all. They did something. They did something. Now I want you to think about that. What if they had just remained at the gate and not took any action? What would have happened? They would have died. Sometimes you have to take bold steps. Make a decision. Now you just don't jump out without analyzing things, without looking at things. But when you pray, committed to the Lord, He will direct you. And sometimes you have to begin to think outside of the box. Sometimes you have to be creative. Now, I'm going to tell you that when you think outside of the box, that does not mean that you do things as morally improper. That means that you do whatever you undertake must be morally upright, legal, just, and without reproach. But sometimes, you know what I mean by thinking outside of the box? I always hear Derek talking about thinking outside of the box. He's an out of the box thinker. And sometimes when I hear, I go, okay. Y'all know he's an out of the box thinker. Now, I'm thinking about another person who was a out-of-the-box kind of thinker. You heard about Les Brown. I know Brother Williams has. Some of you heard about Les Brown. I was had the occasion to be in one of his meetings one time, and I heard him give this account, and I've heard it said different ways, but I'm going to tell you what I heard from him. Probably there are different versions of it. I think he's a out-of-the-box kind of thinker. Before he became famous, if you will, before he became a motivational speaker, he had a shoeshine stand. And he was somewhere, I don't know if it were on the streets or wherever, shoeshine to try to earn some money. And how many of you know that sometimes you have many, many ventures before you're successful? Fail at many things before you're successful. He was there, and people were coming by. Ma'am, would you like a shoeshine today? No. The gentleman came by. Excuse me, sir, would you like a shoeshine today? No. Excuse me, ma'am, would you like a shoeshine today? No. Out of the box kind of thinker. He said, okay, he devised his plan. Now, I'm not telling you to do this, but I'm telling you that this is what he did. You draw your own inference. He said, I got to do something differently here. And many times we have to do something different. He started, excuse me, ma'am, today is my birthday. And I said, the 100th person that came by, I was going to give him a free shoe shine. Would you like your shoe shine today? Oh, of course. And he did such a good job. Now, his shoe shines were $5. He did such a good job that they gave him $10. Oh, that's pretty good. Then the next person came by, excuse me, ma'am, today's my birthday. And I said, the next person that came by, I was going to give them, no, before that happened, he looked up and he started counting, 98, 99, 100. And he said, I said, the next person that came by, I was going to give them a complimentary shoe shine. Then that person, they shined, he gave him a nice tip, and he thought, this is working. So he started counting again, 98, 99, 100. Excuse me, sir, would you like your shoe shine today? I said that the 100th person that came by, I was going to give them a complimentary shoe shine. Sure, I would. You know, all of us like free stuff, don't we? We like free things. So he did it well and gave him a nice tip. So when he left that day, he had a nice stash. What did he do different? What did he do? I want you to think, what did he do different? The little $5 sign wasn't netting him anything. He began to think outside the box. And when he began to think outside of the box, what happened? Now, I said, for all of us, whatever we do must be legal, upright, just, and moral. Now, you can think outside of the box and not do that kind of thing. I thought it was pretty clever. I'm not sure it was just moral, but there was a story in it. And that was, he learned to be creative. In other words, when something is not working for you, and you keep doing it and over again, tell me what that is. Insanity. So you gotta start thinking outside of the box. And as I stand here this morning, and I look over and I see the pews empty, that lets me know that we have got to start thinking outside of the box to get these pews filled. We must start thinking outside the box because the traditional approach has not worked that well. Now, God has, I want to give you another example of thinking outside the box. When I was a kid, my mother, yeah, they're coming. I've got 5 minutes. My mother used to tell me that during the Depression, that there was a garbage collectors, she was told, were going out of business because people just didn't have money. There were soup lines, and there were just people were hungry for food. And I don't know what happened to the garbage, but they weren't collecting the garbage. There were a lot of them going out of business. So there was this one man who thought outside of the box. All of the garbage collectors' trucks were gray and dismal looking. He decided to have his painted hot pink. An out of the box thinker. Should I tell you what happened? His business began to boom. And he had so much business, he became very wealthy as the others went out of business. Out of the box thinking. Who would have ever thought of a hot pink garbage truck? Now, God gives us, each one of us, he's deposited something in us. All of us have creative ability. What is he giving you? What did he give you? You become one of those out of the box kind of thinkers. Now, I want to close with this. I'm just a little bit over, but I gotta read this to you. I wanna close with the brick story. Many of you have heard this, but I think it was so apropos to when you're in desperate situation, what do you do? Firstly, you turn to the Word. You've got to know that you are connected with Him. You're plugged in, you're hooked up, and you're plugged in, just like you plug our iron in. When you unplug it, there's no heat flowing through there. You can't get it. But over and above being connected, sometimes we're in real desperate situations and we have to do something. I'm going to read this to expedite time. You've heard of a brick, many of you, but let me just say it, read it anyway. A young and successful executive was traveling down a neighborhood street, going a bit too fast in his new Jaguar. He was watching for the kids darting out between parked cars, and he slowed down when he thought he saw something. As his car passed, there were no children. Instead,